Is there a reason why quantum mechanics and general relativity cannot be brought together? Burkhard Heim found the reason, and once we reach the end of this video and his central eigenvalue equation, you will understand why that is so and why all the other modern approaches are futile. Hello and welcome to Six Dimensions and Color. My name is Hannes Schmid and I explain to you Burkhard Heim's worldview and theories in understandable language and with clear examples. Thank you for all you awesome supporters and all who want to learn more about Burkhard Heim. Today will be a passage of it will be a little gibberish, but at the end I promise you it will be very interesting and touch very, very substantial, very fundamental topics of our worldview. Now, let us remember what we have considered. We have considered that structure and energy correspond. We have considered that space itself is quantized and that microcosmos and macrocosmos correspond. And from that, we have derived this equation A equal lambda times L. It can be interpreted like the structuring of space requires energy. And structure and energy are related by these lambdas, which are, as will turn out, sets of eigenvalues. Okay, let us look how we come to this conclusion that the lambdas are in fact eigenvalues. Let us use the eigenvalue equation of the structural operator again. So first, H acting on psi, the psi being the state function of space-time, equals lambda times L operator on state function, and that equals lambda times eigenvalues of the L operator times the state function. By the way, the K and M indexes of the lambda symbols, it's a little premature maybe to say they are eigenvalues, but at the end it will turn out they are eigenvalues, and then it will be obvious that they don't have tensor properties or anything. Therefore, we use this neutral notation in order not to confuse them with covariant, contravariant, etc. Now, of course, we require that our expected energy values must converge if they shall have any meaning. And therefore, on each side of this equation, we add psi and psi conjugate and subtract the conjugate itself and integrate that. That must be zero as a result. So let us look at this equation for a moment. We are allowed to pull the eigenvalues being on the left, on the right hand side, we can pull them in front of the integral because they are constant values. On the right hand side, there remains psi times psi conjugate under the integral, and that by definition equals 1, so we can cancel this term out. Then we can state the H operators and the eigenvalues, lowercase l, they are Hermitian by definition. Or rather general, the both operators, H, uppercase H and L, were Hermitian and so must be their eigenvalues. And now let's do a comparison of both sides of the equation. Because if H is Hermitian, and our lowercase l eigenvalues are Hermitian, then there's only one possibility to fulfill this equation. Then the lambdas must be Hermitian eigenvalues as well. So in this way, we can show that we had indeed an eigenvalue equation at the end of the last video. Now let us look again at our state function psi and its relation to the microscopic three-pointer symbol, phi, phi with three indexes. We found this relation that phi acting on psi equals L acting on psi, and that equals eigenvalues of L multiplied by psi. That's the first relation. And on the other hand, for the macroscopic energy state, which we had represented by G, we found that there is that they correspond to the microcosmos as like G acting on psi, that corresponds to the microscopic energy state that is represented by H acting on psi. So let us look at these macroscopic energy states here. We now can substitute H by lambda times L. We get H acting on psi equals lambda times L acting on psi. And L acting on psi, that corresponds, that's equivalent to phi acting on psi. Sorry, it's a little tongue twisting here. So we yield lambda times phi acting on psi. If we now draw back the arc to the energy correspondence, we get G acting on psi equals lambda times phi acting on psi. And now just one more trick. Let's remember we had to define G equals the CP operator acting on phi, because this is the correspondence between macroscopic and microscopic energy states. And from that, we finally get Heim's main eigenvalue equation, CP acting on phi equals lambda times phi. We have discrete point spectra here in terms of the lambda values, and therefore this equation fulfills the basic requirement of quantization. And if we look at this equation now, we find that it has a very similar structure, interestingly, as the Schrödinger equation, which is Hamiltonian on psi, meaning where uppercase psi is the probability state function, equals energy state times probability state function. But the similarity ends here, because our CP operator on the left-hand side of the Heim equation is a non-linear one. The Hamilton operator is linear, and therefore the psi's can be interpreted as probability states which can linearly superimpose. Remember how we defined the CP operator? It was defined from this relation known from general relativity, where the Ricci tensors, the reduction of the Riemann tensor, is deducted by CP from the three-pointer symbol, from the Christoffel symbols in the macrocosmos. And this was transitioned into the microcosmos in the very similar way. And you cannot superimpose, you cannot add up simply these nonlinear relations. And here we are at the core and the fundamental reason why it never succeeded to join quantum mechanics with general relativity, why it was never possible to align the phenomena of probability of electromagnetic properties of particles with their mass property. It's, by the way, also the reason I'm not using bracket symbols in this equation, like would be the case in normal quantum mechanics for these kind of equations, but it simply does not apply here. QM and GRT cannot come together because of this fundamental difference in their mathematical approach. And the mathematical approach is just a symptom of a very different philosophy here. And there must be shed light on it, because that's a central error of our today's worldview, our conception of physics. Heisenberg and his buddies, they said that quantum mechanics, the observations of quantum mechanics, was something fundamentally real. They said, okay, we observe this probability behavior, this indeterminism or this wave-particle dualism, and this must be fundamental properties of reality, although it contradicts all our intuition. But this is like setting up an artificial boundary in your head. This was criticized by Einstein. This was criticized by David Bohm, who suggested a quantum mechanics that has hidden variables and is deterministic in a virtual way, so to speak. But Heim offers something even better here. And there's also an ontological reason why this equation must be true. Why Heim's equation must be true. The lambdas, they're discrete point spectra, And that's exactly what we observe with masses, particle masses. Particle masses are something very discrete. We know them by many digits after the comma. They are not smeared or something like they would be probabilities. Masses are something very specific. They're not likely to be that way and likely to be that way. And that results directly from the nonlinearity of this equation. Now, I'm not saying that quantum mechanics is completely wrong. I'm saying we must not ontologize it. The mathematics is, it works. But the mathematics is only a language how to describe a philosophical attitude or your metaphysical approach to the world. And if you say that uncertainty, etc., is fundamental, then you are, I think that's a fundamental error. And it can be proven with Heim theory. In fact, the phenomena of quantum theory can be, they will become much better understandable further on in Heim theory when we get to macro collectives, etc. But that's still a little way far on. Any expectation that a theory of elementary particles must be a theory of quantum theory, or must regard the preconceptions of quantum theory. That's the wrong way to go. It simply can lead nowhere. It was also criticized on Heim theory that would not regard quantum theory, but that's simply a preconception. Quantum theory is like a good engineering application. It's fact that it does work well in computers, it does work well in our mobile phones, but nothing more. It's nothing for metaphysics, it's just something we can calculate with. And to be absolutely watertight here in terms of scientific theory, a wrong theory can yield correct results within certain boundaries, like the Copernican planetary model with its epicycles. It yielded correct results for the application of that time when it was valid. And the Kepler model with its ellipses around the sun, where the sun was set into the center. At first, the results of the Kepler model were worse than that of the Copernican. There had to be some detailing before it was completely understood and yielded better results. So let's not shed quantum theory for that, but let's keep in mind it's only a basic. And as a last remark, I also oppose this use of quantum theory, or shall I say abuse, to lay proof for esoteric concepts or phenomena of consciousness. It's not sound to simply ontologize the mathematical language that was built around it and say that's reality. Reality is much more interesting because it has six dimensions and is colorful.